Hey everybody, it's Ian O'Byrne again. It's Saturday, October 7th. I'm taking a look behind the scenes at what happened this week and also what I covered in issue number 118 of the Too Long Didn't Read newsletter. This was sometimes this newsletter, as I've said in the past, like it goes very easy, and sometimes it's a bit of a challenge to sort of weave together the newsletter. This is one of those ones that I saw a couple themes throughout the week, and I was trying to draw them together. And then there's also a lot of other events that happened this week as well that sort of, charged a lot of the, things I wanted to write about and talk about. So I pulled the quote from Star Wars, and I think that it'll be pretty obvious why I pulled this quote. Each week when I figure out what the title of the newsletter is, sometimes I would have like two or three keywords, and sometimes I'd have, a little statement or like a colloquialism. But then at this, the last couple weeks I've had like song lyrics. And this week, this, quote from Star Wars really stuck to me. I also, this week I put together, this post on healthy skepticism. This comes straight out of my dissertation. As I was working on my dissertation, which focused on critical evaluation of online information, we were talking about, well, how do we build up these critical evaluation skills in students? And I don't think that the checklist, approach works. I don't think it works when we basically give students like a list of does that .edu or .com or, are the links working or broken? Primarily because students, they're not carrying these checklists around with them. They need to sort of internalize these behaviors. And at the same time, I think that, the checklist approach oversimplifies. There's errors of oversimplification as we try and think about like, well, it has, the website has these things, but it doesn't have those things. I don't think that really works anymore, especially now when we're in this age where people are actively spreading mistruths and trying to trick you. So they'll put out content that looks very credible, but it's absolutely bogus. And so my thinking is that I want to basically prepare students to be healthy skeptics. I think that they should question everything and doubt everything that they see. This is not a new idea by any stretch of the imagination. This is all about critical literacy and its critical thinking skills. But in the past, as I've talked about healthy skepticism, I've had a lot of pushback from colleagues that say, well, what if the skepticism is not healthy? So I wanted to basically get this post out. I've seen other colleagues talking about healthy skepticism in their research, so I wanted to get this out there first. And then I have two or three other posts, that I'll put in after this. To unpack it a little bit more and say, okay, well, what happens when this skepticism is not healthy? Specifically, what I'm thinking about is we see a lot of recent stories and a lot of news about how we have a lot of, individuals that are, pushing back against the establishment and pushing back against and questioning, pretty much everything going on in the world. There's a lot of people that don't trust each other. And so where's the fine line between healthy skepticism and that lack of trust? So hopefully I could pull that out in an upcoming blog post. I'm trying to decide if it's a blog post on its own or if I send it out someplace like hybrid pedagogy. And then how to make it happen. I talk about different things you can do in your classroom, but then I also see a lot of connections to design thinking. I've done a little bit of research on design thinking and I'm waiting to hear back on a pub in review. And then also building in coding and programming and computational thinking into your classroom. So I put out that post. I also did a video on Google custom search and how you can use that in your elementary, in your classroom to help students search and sift through internet texts, but basically create like a little internet sandbox for them to look through. I share this video, it's a Tiny Desk concert. This one is with Odyssey, but I absolutely love the, Tiny Desk series from NPR. The gist of it is, if you haven't seen it already, What they basically try to do is they put together, let me find the main post. They put together a music series. NPR was trying to figure out, National Public Radio. They wanted to put together a music series, but they didn't want to do pretty much the same thing that's always been done. So what they decided to do is basically strip down the artists and put together like little concerts at the most simplistic, most ridiculous place that they could have you perform. And so what they do is basically in an office, in the main producers of the show, they bring artists in and they put together songs and concerts in the artists of the people that run the show. And so it's a lot of fun. It's, you know, you have country acts, you have folk singers, you have rappers, you have pretty much everybody under the sun will come in and they will perform and just strip down their act, people that you never thought that you would see there. And the concerts are, you know, pretty short, you know, they're 15, 20 minutes long. And so what we do in my house is we watch way too much YouTube, thanks to my NVIDIA Shield TV. And so what we do is we basically pull up NPR, or pick, you know, pull up this playlist of the Tiny Desk concerts, and just let it play throughout the night. So if we're having a party and people come over, we'll have this playing on the TV and the music is playing throughout the house. And it's a good conversation piece. And it's a lot of fun. So this piece by Odyssey, the reason why I picked him out of the others is one, it's an incredible performance, but then also I definitely recommend checking out this video here that he just released. And it's all about people changing as they grow up. It's a really thoughtful piece. The animation and the video itself is really interesting. Definitely recommend checking it out, especially given some of the stuff that we've been talking about here in Too Long Didn't Read. So the first piece that I share out is about the shootings that happened in Las Vegas late Sunday night, early Monday morning. This was important for me on a couple different levels, and it was hard for me on a couple different levels. One, I think that it's always a case of when, not if, something like this will happen. So, you know, I've seen a lot of violence in my time teaching in middle school and high school. And then also, as I've gone off to teach in higher ed, you know, I've told colleagues that we need to be vigilant and we need to be aware of, you know, the fact that increasingly schools are soft targets. It's not anything that anyone likes to talk about, but I've seen far too much. And then as I try to hasten my colleagues to start thinking about it and, you know, perhaps worrying about it, you know, then all of a sudden we see more events happen. So I was working at University of New Haven when Sandy Hook happened not too far from our campus. You know, we had connections to Sandy Hook and we had connections to, my department had connections to, you know, at least one of the teachers that was, you know, killed at Sandy Hook. So a lot of this stuff, you know, it seems like I have concerns about it and I worry about it and I tell my colleagues. And then sometimes there's like a, oh, we don't have to worry about it. Like that's a negative thought process. Like we don't want to really, you know, get people upset. And then something like that happens. And then sadly, I'm correct. And so, you know, and then weeks later at University of New Haven, all of a sudden somebody, you know, came onto campus with a couple rifles and started walking through campus and didn't shoot anybody, but all, you know, it was basically the campus was on lockdown. So it's thoughts like this, you know, it's situations like this that really make me concerned about what happens. So that's one level, and I'll have more information and more resources coming, you know, with it. Before I move on, please just, you know, if you're on a campus, if you work in a school, make yourself aware that, you know, if this were to occur, what would you do? A lot of the research suggests that in high stakes, high stress environments, as human beings, what we usually do is it's either fight or flight or freeze. And we see a lot of people that just freeze. They don't know what to do. We saw this happen, you know, in September 11th and a lot of emergencies. People freeze up. Sometimes You know, they can fight, and other times, you know, people just take off and run. So, I mean, be aware that if this were to happen, you know, I'd rather see, you know, fight or flight as opposed to freezing. So just make yourself aware. I have a resource in there in higher ed and what you should do. And I'm working on stuff for K-12, at least trying to gather information. So this piece, what it's getting at is, it's looking at what social media did, meaning Google and Facebook and 4chan and a lot of these other, you know, online spaces. What was their response and some of the garbage news and some of the hoaxes that they, you know, instantaneously put to the top of their feeds? And it's mainly an issue with the algorithms, and a lack of the human touch behind all of it to show what's true and what's not. So as people were trying to get information, as soon as it was happening, there's a lot of bogus news that all the trolls and the hate mongers all spread. The other reason why I'm sharing this is that I'm wondering, like, for me, enough is enough. And I'm sure enough is enough for many of you. And so I'm wondering, like, what do we do about this? Sadly, it seems like we're having this normalization where an event happens. You know, we saw the shootings in the Orlando nightclub, or we see terror attacks overseas, and we talk about it for a couple days. You know, Orlando, we talked about it for about 2 weeks, and then we seem to move on, and we forget these horrific events. And even with this, you know, mass shooting in Vegas, it seems like after a couple days, you know, we've moved on, and we don't really talk about it as much, and we don't change anything. So I'm wondering, what do we do about that? You know, I mean, if I share a tweet or something on Facebook, does that really matter at all? If I go protest, does that really matter? You know, what do we actually do to change some of this? That's one of the real things that I'm trying to figure out. The second thing, and I say at the top of the newsletter, this was a hard newsletter to write. There's a lot of things that I felt like I had to talk about and cover that I didn't want to. The Las Vegas shooting was one of them. And the second was this sort of like leak, this cache of documents that came out about Breitbart and the hate and misogyny and xenophobia and their, you know, not only willingness, but their desire to spread this. And so it's really interesting and very disturbing to read some of the behind the scenes. And it's very disturbing to read about certain people and individuals that are, you know, either giving money or giving tips, or, you know, they would look at somebody online or somebody in politics that was giving them a hard time, and they would go to somebody at Breitbart and say, hey, we should write some garbage about this person, and here's a good story that we could write about them, and here's some garbage news that we could spread about them. And then the next day, this ridiculous story that was basically spawned from one sentence in an email, you know, pops up on Breitbart, and then all of the trolls and the platforms basically push it. So it's very disturbing to me that this is happening, that, you know, we have a website that's actively trying to push it. The other thing is that immediately I started thinking about Gamergate, and Gamergate really bothered me. It really had me thinking, and I was teaching at UNH at the time and working with teachers to help them be experts in technology. And so we really thought about Gamergate, and we started to conduct some research on Gamergate, specifically the Wikipedia page and make sense of it. And now, if you look back in time, you could basically see that we should have learned more about ourselves and learned more from Gamergate, because I think that, you know, one, I'm amazed that not a lot of people know about it. I mean, it bothers me. I think there's a lot of people that were in it, and I wasn't in it, that it really bothered. But now we look back, and there's lessons that we should have learned from Gamergate that we, for the most part, did not. And so it's interesting to look back in time at some of this and see, you know, a lot of the die being cast. I also shared this, the keynote from Dana Boyd. It talks about our data being manipulated and how, you know, bias is built into the system, bias is built into the code. And there is, you can watch a portion of the keynote and you can read her text there. One of the things that really, there's a couple of quotes that really spoke to me from this. And, you know, it's a lot of the stuff about bias and perspective and hate that we've been talking a lot about in Too Long Didn't Read over the last couple months. But one of the things that really intrigued me is this last one about, you know, tech is no longer a bunch of geeks trying to do cool stuff in the world. It's now, as I've said many times, the internet is the dominant text of our generation. So these platforms and these tools are the foundation of a lot of democratic social systems. And we need to come to terms with that and start to do more to actually protect it and not just let a lot of these hate mongers in to sort of like do as they see fit with it. Moving on, I gave a talk this week, and I have the slide deck there, at my son's old elementary school. And we're talking about screen time. I've been working with a colleague on, first of all, we have a publication coming out in pediatrics on parenting in the age of screen time. So it's for pediatrics. It's a different audience than we usually talk to. And one of the colleagues on that, we're working on either a journal article or, you know, perhaps a book. So we're in between on ideas, but thinking about something about screen time and trying to give advice on what the real best steps are. And so we basically took at it, you know, I took some of the initial outlines and structure of that and did a talk on screen time. Slides are there for you. And I got a lot of interesting feedback from the parents that were there. You know, some parents are basically like, you know, my child doesn't watch TV at all during the week, or I only let them watch TV and play video games on like Sunday nights. And I'm like, well, that's very impressive. Like, do you actually do that or not? And then there's a lot of other parents that basically try to balance things out. And then there's obviously parents that just don't care. So we're trying to make sense of it. And it was interesting, some of the feedback that they gave. In the middle of the talk, it had me thinking two things. One, this post that I saw where basically students said, you know, we, a lot of times as parents, I think what we do is we, you know, we think we know what's best for students, and we think we know what's best for children, and we think we know it's what children want to do with these digital texts and tools. But as evidenced by this post here from The Guardian and then also Dana Boyd's book, It's Complicated, I don't think we, A, really know what kids want from these social media platforms, and B, I don't think we really know what their relationships will be with this. You know, many of, you know, I grew up and the internet came into my life and I obviously use it a lot, but then at the same time, you know, my son and my daughter, they're growing up and they won't know a world before the internet. You know, they might know a world after the internet, but they don't know a world before it. So it's just this ubiquitous presence that's in their lives. And so growing up in that, my thoughts are that all of these fears that we have that, you know, oh, well, they will just be zombies and it'll be Ready Player One where everybody's connected into like the Matrix. I don't know if that's entirely true. Granted, we won't know until decades from now, but I think that we need to take a step back and try and think about, okay, what might actually happen with all this. I wrap up the reading section on Why Do Smart People Do Foolish Things. Really interesting piece where Heather Butler's talking about what's the difference between like intelligence and critical thinking, and showing some research that she and colleagues conducted, trying to separate it out and basically suggesting that, you know, we think that intelligence will get you far, which it can and it might. But then perhaps critical thinking skills is really what you need to get you through and to really be the best that you can be. In the making section, once again, making is it's coding and hacking and building things and playing and productivity. And part of making I see is always cooking and trying to build different things and cook. And this one is all about little, as they call them, visiting cakes or little quick breads. And so this week, my son and I started, we've been cooking for a while because he's been really interested in it. And so this popped up, you know, serendipitously into my New York Times feed, and it's a lemon spice visiting cake. And it was, it made me think about my son and I made a chocolate chip quick bread this week. Super simple, but both him and his sister sat and basically devoured that thing for the whole week. They're just amazed that they could cook it. And they were, you know, proud that they made it. So shared it, and definitely interested in trying out the Lemon Space Fight visiting cake. So with all of the other damaging things that we've talked about, then this week's issue, we can at least have cake. And so, of course, Tom Petty passed this week as well. I pulled this quote because I feel like it really went well with this week's issue. And I was thinking initially about just cutting it off at some days are diamonds, some days are rocks. But then I ultimately decided to add the next two lines in the lyrics to it, just to make us think a little bit more about what's going on in the world and what our everydays are like. It was a good week this week. You know, tough at the very beginning. I sort of like walked away from the internet. I had a chance to go present with, I'll show this. I had a chance to present with my son and my daughter at that screen time talk. And what's cool with me, or what's cool for me, is that, you know, my son has come to a lot of talks and helped me present multiple times. He's seven. And my daughter has been into my class when I have taught once, but this was the first time that, like, I went to give a talk and she was there with me and was part of the presentation. So it was fun to, like, bring them out and help and have them help me and let them see what I do, at least part of what I do. So I get to bring my kids out to do a keynote, which is always fun. Once again, this is issue 118 of Too Long Didn't Read. A little bit of the background behind the scenes of this issue, but then also talked a little bit about what's going on this week in the world and in my life. This is Saturday, October 7th, 2017. If you have not subscribed to Too Long Didn't Read, please do so. If this video is worth it to you and you like some of the content here, by all means, please subscribe. I'm constantly building up and revising my use of YouTube, so we have more things to come. And then also, you should be able to find out anything else you want to or don't want to about me on my website. I'm going to find a better way to fold in the video content to this site as well, so that it's all in one spot. Once again, issue number 118 and Too Long Didn't Read. You'll never find a more wretched hive of scum and villainy. So on that note, have a good week, and I'll see you all.